We formed a quorum and it's also the appointed time. Members, return to your own seats since you need to press the request to speak button if you wish to do so. The first thing on the agenda is information papers issued since the last meeting. There is one and it's already set out on the agenda. And the next item is the agenda for our next meeting. The administration has proposed two for us. One is the strategic repositioning plan of Ocean Park, and second, proposed creation of two directorate posts in the Air Accident Investigation Authority. Any questions, please? If members are agreeable, then we move on to item three, which is legislative amendments to implement the latest requirements under conventions of the International Maritime Organization. Please invite officials from the THB to join us. The administration will brief us on four legislative amendments to implement the latest requirements under CIMO, namely, proposals on ban on carriage of fuels not compliant with sulfur content limits, second, application of energy efficiency design index requirements to ice-strengthened ships, and use of electronic record books on board ships. For this item, we have Ms. Angela Lee, Deputy Secretary for Transport and Housing, Ms. Louisa Yan, PAS for Transport and Housing, and from the Marine Department, Mr. Choi Ji Chun, as well as Mr. Stanley Liu. Thank you, Chairman. We'd like to consult members on four proposals to amend legislation to implement the latest requirements under conventions of the International Maritime Organization to honor our international commitments. The first is, all our latest requirements under the International Convention for the Prevention of Pollution from Ships. In order to reduce pollution to our marine environment, the IMO has set the sulfur content limits at 3.5% mass per mass, and it will be reduced to 0.5% mass per mass from January next year. We understand that for ocean-going vessels, when they are on high seas, they may switch to non-compliant fuel. To facilitate enforcement by different member states, IMO adopted a resolution in October last year, which stipulates that the sulfur content limits will apply not only to fuel oil used on board ships, but also to those carried for use on board ships. The new requirement will take effect in March next year globally. And so we have to amend our air pollution regulation to implement the requirements. The second proposed legislative amendment is technical in nature, and that is to better define the energy efficiency design index. This is called EEDI. There is a minimum requirement for ocean-going vessels, but for ice-strengthened ships, they need a higher engine power to negotiate severe ice conditions. So there is a code, and IMO adopted a resolution in 2019 to stipulate that exemption of EEDI requirements would only apply to cargo ships operating in the most severe ice conditions in polar waters, as defined in the International Code for Ship Operating in Polar Vessels. It will come into force in 2020, and therefore we have to amend our air pollution regulation correspondingly. The third amendment involves the use of electronic record books on board ships. In future, electronic record books will be deemed to have the same status as those in paper form. Because IMO requires vessels to keep on board record books to record various ship operations to monitor their discharge of sewage and waste, etc. IMO adopted two resolutions earlier this year to allow the use of electronic record books as an alternative to traditional hard copy record books. We propose to amend the relevant provisions of the Merchant Shipping Prevention and Control of Pollution regulations so as to make it explicit that the use of electronic books will also be allowed. And the fourth legislative amendment involves fire safety requirements for helicopter landing areas on board ships. Some vessels have helipads or landing areas for helicopters. Chapter 2.2 of the Annex to the International Convention for the Safety of Life at Sea and also FSS Code have the requirements, and IMO has adopted resolutions to prescribe requirements on the provision of firefighting appliances for helicopter facilities on board ships, and their requirements on the dimensions and materials for hose reels, nozzles, and pipes used in foam firefighting systems. The requirements will come into force on the 1st of January next year, and we propose to incorporate the amendments into our local legislation by amending the fire safety regulation. We have consulted the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee of the Marine Department in relation to all these proposals, and we plan to submit the subsidiary legislation to this council within this legislative session for negative vetting. Thank you. All right, two members are waiting to ask questions. It will have up to 4 minutes. Mr. Holden Chow.
I noticed that the paper refers to several legislative proposals, and I note that you have consulted the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee. Let me ask this. For myself and our colleagues, we might not be familiar with the marine operations. The paper said that you have consulted the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee. When you consulted them, have they made any special response and suggestions? You said that members generally supported the legislative amendments, but this committee has its expertise and they know about marine operations. So is there any possibility of you telling us their overall comments so that we can take reference when we try to legislate on the matter? We know that the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee has been consulted on the several legislative proposals. So that's my first question. Second question is about the use of electronic record books. We are not familiar with this issue, but let me ask. The paper says that the resolutions will allow the flight administrations to accept electronic record books. Does it mean that right now, that when ships are using electronic record books, these books will not be accepted pending the enactment of the legislation? Two questions. Deputy Secretary, on the question of consultation, let me defer to Mr. Choi, Assistant Director of Marine, to elaborate on the consultation process and whether any special views have been raised. Now, in the IMO, the full discussion has been made at these issues, and ship owners and ship operators may already been fully aware of such legislative amendments. And for the question of electronic record books, They will take effect only in October next year. And whether the individual vessels have opted to use the electronic record books right now is up to them to decide. But for Hong Kong, we have to amend our legislation first before the Marine Department can accept the electronic book records made by ships. So for the first question, can I defer to the Assistant Director of Marine? Thank you, Chairman. On the first question, the paper refers to international practices and legislation, which has been discussed for several years at the IMO. And Hong Kong ship owners during that period have understood quite well such proposals. So when we submitted the paper for discussion at this advisory committee, all the members basically supported our legislative proposals. Follow-up? Yes, I have one follow-up. Of course, I understand that, as pointed out by the paper, the advisory committee supports these proposals because these are requirements of the IMO, after all. But my worry is that since we are not familiar with these expert or specialized area, I wonder whether they have raised any special views which should be brought to our attention. So maybe after the meeting, can you provide the information in this regard? So can you provide such information to us after the meeting, Chairman? On the four legislative proposals in the paper, during the course of consultation, the members of the advisory committee have not raised any technical views because they know about these all along. Very often, these members would meet with the relevant requirements accordingly, so they fully support the legislative proposals. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, for the several amendments proposed, they are to meet with the latest requirements under the conventions of the IMO. So Hong Kong is obliged to follow these. The proposals cover several areas. One is about the silver content limit, so that pollution can be reduced. So this is very much an overall trend. As for the use of electronic record books on ships, again, this is a trend because we are going into the age of electronic records and paperless. Now, as for fire safety requirements for helicopter landing areas on board ships, of course, we have to do that. I'm not targeting these technical amendments, so to speak. There shouldn't be any problem. These are very much required because we have to follow the International Marine Convention. So there should not be any dispute over that. Now, I'm concerned about the timing because these proposals come with different enforcement date. So it seems that these will take effect in 2020. And you know that we haven't yet been able to elect the chairman of the House Committee. So we have to go through the legislative procedures involving the House Committee. Then it's difficult for us to actually to make sure that we can meet the relevant schedule. So can you explain more about the timing here? Now, if we miss dealing with this in this current legislative session, then that will be carried over to the next session. Then we don't know who will sit on the panel next time. So if we miss the timetable prescribed by the IMO, will there be any problem? Is there any flexibility? And also, on another technical issue, Would you be having this legislation subject to negative vetting or what? So it would be subject to negative vetting. So Deputy Secretary, can you explain? Thank you, Dr. Lo. The government has been working hard to make sure that the local legislative work can really dovetail the international legislation. We submit the legislation within this legislative session. For the four legislative proposals, they are subject to the negative vetting process, and it will not be done through positive vetting. We hope to simplify things, and if members support us in this meeting, we will commence with the drafting, and then we will try to submit the proposals ASAP to the Council. So will you be doing the several proposals separately, or would you be amalgamating all those? We would do it by batches, separately. Mr. Wong Ting-Kwang, thank you, Chairman. My question is the same as Dr. Lo Wai Kwok's. I'm also very worried about the working of the legislative session. This is the last year in the legislative term. Since we are raising this only today, can we really meet the timetable? Up to now, the House Committee has not been able to function normally. We're still electing the chairperson. And the DS talked about the negative vetting process. I can be reassured more if that is done. If you have a scrutiny deadline, well, I believe these are just technical amendments, which are really to meet with the conventions under the IMO. My question is the same as Dr. Lowe's, so I will not repeat my question. I support the proposals. DS, I have a simple question. Did the Marine Department take part in the discussion of the IMO? Yes, the deputy or assistant director is stationed in London, and he takes part in discussions of the IMO. And if he knows that there will be certain items coming up in the future meetings, and the Marine Department colleagues at Hong Kong will consult the trade and reflect the views of the marine sector to the London colleague, who can then reflect our views to the IMO. Now, in the unfortunate event that the legislation cannot be passed, what will be the consequences? Well, these are the subsidiary legislation, so that can be subject to negative vetting. Of course, the IMO has specified the enforcement date for all the four legislative proposals. And these apply to ships in Hong Kong as well. For a ship which comes to Hong Kong, it also goes to other ports all around the world. So all these ships normally will get prepared, because if they visit other ports, then they will be checked as to whether they comply with the requirements of the IMO, which have been enforced all over the world. So even if we could not do everything in time, then the vessels should already have made the relevant preparations, because they have to meet the requirements in other ports. For example, they would have already installed the fire installation, fire safety equipment on board. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, I think, Chairman, you've raised a very good question. And the answer is understandable, because the ships are traveling everywhere in the world. So even if the laws in Hong Kong have not taken effect, the ships would already have made all the arrangements to meet with the international requirements, because they are traveling to other ports. So what is embarrassing for us is for simple things like these, and Hong Kong would be saying to the international organization that we have not been able to do it. Apart from, you know, putting ourselves in an embarrassing position, there would not be other consequences, right? Yes. DS, well, it's exactly because of this that we would like to get the legislation enacted within this legislative session, and we hope we look forward to members' support. Sometimes the timetable for local legislation may not dovetail with the enforcement date of the international requirements. And the IMO understands well that sometimes we might do things through administrative measures and then notify the relevant ships that the requirements to be complied with. The most ideal scenario, of course, is that our timetable can match with that of the international timetable. So if there is no further question, do members support this legislative amendment? Any further question? Yes, we support the proposal. Thank you, DS. So we move on to the next agenda item. And that is to the legislative amendments to implement the, it should be the resources proposals relating to the governed facilities and equipment to support the three runway system at Hong Kong International Airport. So can we invite the team from the Transport and Housing Bureau to join us, please? The team comprises government officials from different departments like the CNED, Police, Transport and Housing Bureau, Buildings Department, or rather RTSD, etc. So I'm not going to introduce the government officials one by one here. So if you would like to ask a question, please press the button first. So now I would like to invite the head of the Airport Expansion Project Coordination Office, Mr. Raymond Chang, to walk us through the paper, please.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, members of the panel. In 2016, August, the Airport Authority started the 3-hour AS works, hoping that by 2022, the 3-hour AS could be commissioned and to complete the whole 3-hour AS system within 2024. In order to tie in with the operation of the 3-hour AS, we have to provide the necessary government facilities to comply with ICAO requirements and for the operation of various facilities. Now, we ask for proposed resources. The first batch got the first batch of government facilities and equipment, including those for CAD, HKO, and Fire Services Department, had electrical FC support in January 2018, and then the works started in mid-2019 in order to support the commissioning of the 3-hour AS in 2022. Now, today, we are talking about another batch of facilities, including the aviation meteorological systems to support the 3-hour AS, and also provision of facilities and accommodation for various government departments to support the 3-hour AS, and also provision of police facilities. For details, please refer to the paper. Now, the Hong Kong Observatory needs to provide the relevant meteorological aviation facilities like procurement of radar and also aviation meteorological equipment, and to provide both the software and hardware so as to collect the relevant data for aviation safety. Now, for the other projects, now in the new in the third runway passenger building and expanded terminal 2, and at different areas of the area, provide facilities for six different government departments to provide the security facilities to support the operation of the 3-hour AS. And third is on the reclamation area, construct a new airport district operational base, and at the existing airport police station, alteration works have to be undertaken. After consulting this panel, we will follow the usual procedures. In due course, we'll apply for funding from LegCo. the relevant works will have to start in mid-2020 in order to align with the progress of the 3LS, and so that we can commission the third runway in 2022 in time, and for the whole system to be commissioned in 2024. Thank you. Five members have pressed the request to speak button. Mr. Christopher Jiang can be followed by Mr. Wai Kwok. Mr. Christopher Jiang. Thank you, Chairman. Before we talked about the 3LS of the Hong Kong International Airport, like now, the 3LS is very important to both passenger and freight traffic for Hong Kong. However, because of the social unrest in the past 6 months, visitors' arrivals and freight traffic have been affected. There is a 43% drop in visitors' arrivals. So will the 3LS be able to achieve its planned targets? Because due to reduction in passenger arrival and freight traffic, the income may reduce, and will you have to charge an airport tax in order to cover the cost? Now you will you are going to spend $3 billion and also $60 billion on the construction works. Can you give us a breakdown of the cost, please? And now you are going to construct a new operational base for the air district. How is it different from the current operational base? Can you tell us what new facilities can be found in the new operational base? Regarding the drop in passenger arrivals, the AA closely monitor such figures as announced in October. There was a drop in arrivals and also freight traffic as a result of recent social incidents. Undeniably, recent social events have taken toll on these aspects. However, the current dual runways have already reached their maximum capacity. We have over 420,000 arrivals and departures every year. We need the third runway to meet our demand all the way until 2030. We'll closely monitor the operation of the industry. We will formulate measures to maintain Hong Kong's position as an international aviation hub. These measures can include transit arrangements. Because of the Greater Bay Area concept, our airport doesn't just serve local residents. There will be transit arrangements so we can serve GBA as well. As regards the breakdown, now we are only given some rough estimates of the two projects, and they have yet to be finalized. We'll provide a detailed breakdown when we go to PWSC, including installation and systems. We will give a full account in the PWSC paper. Now, we are not going to exceed the projected cost provided in this paper, but we are still finalizing the details. What about the operational base? Please be brief. I'm sure some other members will ask the same question. Can ASD please help? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Jiang, for your question. For the design of the operational base OB, it is a single block with 8 stories. There will be indoor drilling grounds and firing ranges, and there will also be some other facilities. So then the decoration will be practical and will not be luxurious. Mr. Lawaiko, I have to declare interest. I've been appointed to the board of Airport Authority since the middle of this year. I'm also a chairman of the 3RS Project Committee. So that's my declaration of interest. As we all know, AA is responsible for funding the 3RS with funding sources from various aspects. Now, the facilities for government departments will be funded by the government. Last year, the FC approved $770 million to support facilities for the Civil Aviation Department, Hong Kong Observatory, and FSD. And this time, they need our further support. And 3RS works taking place in full swing, and government facilities are also needed, and we have to dovetail the overall program of the 3RS, and that's why AA has got this paper. I've already declared my interest involved, and if a vote has to be taken, I will not take part. But even from an ordinary member of the public's point of view, such works are needed. All right, Mr. Holden Chow. Mr. Holden Chow, thank you. Thank you, Chairman. The 3RS project is underway, and then and they will be fully commissioned in 2024. The supporting departments need facilities in the new system. Now, recently, we have had a social unrest. I'd like to know whether they have reviewed their plans and arrangement in relation to the recent social incidents. Will there be adjustment in the design in order to cater for similar incidents? Because we have seen occasions when the airport was obstructed, and also some vandalism. Is the administration going to strengthen security in the airport as a result? Mr. Zheng, thank you. Now, for the operational base of the airport district, now, most of the new facilities to be provided are on the air side. So, we have considered the trend of terrorist attacks in the periphery of the airport. And the airport police station, APS, is the current one is very far away from the 3RS, and we need a new OB to be closer to the 3RS. Perhaps the police can supplement in this regard. Any supplements from the police? Thank you, Mr. Zhang, and thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chow, for your question. and new security safeguards in relation to the recent social unrest. Now we have applied for injunctions together with the security company of the airport. We have enhanced the control of entry and departure from the airport, and we have strengthened security measures. The ASD will consider the design of the operational base. However, we're not within the air side. We are in the eastern support area, and we have taken into account the factor you mentioned in the facilities for the police at the airport. Any follow-up? No. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chairman.
All right. The Air District OB will involve extra manpower as well. Can we be given
the manpower plan, and will police officers at the management rank be stationed here? And I'd like to know whether ADOB
will be responsible for policing and to protect the airport from threat of terrorism, or will it be tasked to carry out all policing work? Now, you, according to your paper, deployment of manpower from the old OB will be rather inconvenient, since the current OB is quite far away from the 3R, the third runway. Have you considered replacing the old one with the new one? It is better than having two OBs. Because when you have two OBs, there may be duplication of efforts in terms of deployment and also other planning.
On the question of manpower, when the 3RS is fully commissioned, the area will be increased by 50%. Now it's at 1,200 hectares, and that will be an increase of 600 hectares. And the cargo throughput will be 9 million tons, and the passengers will reach 100 million. So apart from adding facilities, we'll need to increase manpower as well. So various departments are now planning and calculating their manpower. So when you come to the PWSC, can you give us information on the staff establishment proposed? In the paper, there will be annual expenditure. I'm not asking about expenditure. I'm talking about the establishment. So when we come up with sums on the expenditure, staff establishment is also included. So when you come to the PWSC, will you include information like that? Yes, we'll go back and see what can be included. There will be information and resources required for every year. So the other two questions, can I ask the police is to take the question. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for your question, and thank you, Mr. Chang. The first question is about the different job types at the airport district. Mr. Wu may not be very clear about this. Let me try to explain further. The airport district now has different formations responsible for different jobs. There are basically two formations. At the airport district, there will be colleagues doing daily patrols. They will prevent and detect crimes and maintain the law and order at the district, at the airport. We will also deal with crime investigation, also simple emergency situations. We will respond to the request for help from the members of the public, and we will enforce the bylaws. And then the second area is counterterrorism and also emergency situations relating to airport or aviation safety. The special duty unit at the police district in the airport will be responsible for that. They will deal with different airport emergency incidents, they will also work on counter-terrorism activities. They will also take part in protecting important persons, VIPs, and they will also conduct regular drills together with different stakeholders and government departments stationed at the airport. Sorry, Chairman. So my question really is on this. Since we have high requirements on counterterrorism measures at the airport, will the team at the airport be deployed outside their normal duties to take on duties like stopping violence and curbing chaos and so on? For the special duty unit at the airport, a small number of the unit members have undergone special tactical training, and in the past exercises, they have helped out, and they take up around 10% of the manpower in the airport district. But despite this, the airport security or safety or passenger safety has not been compromised, the reason being that around one-third of the police officers are on duty on a daily basis. And for the remainder of the police officers, they are involved in other duties. As I said, 10% of the police officers have undergone special tactical training to help up, make up a shortfall in manpower in certain situations. And sometimes we may change three shift to a two-shift rosters. Sometimes it would maybe try to cancel some lessons, training, and ask the police officers not to take leave in emergency situations. We will also work together with the security companies in maintaining law and order in the airside and landside areas of the airport. As I said, 10% of the police officers are involved in all these work. Ms. Claudia Mo, we are talking about a paper talking about over $5 billion. You talk about the meteorological system in the airport, and that's not a problem. But then for the other departments' facilities, we're talking about $3 billion. And the third item related to the police facilities, $1.8 billion. The first item is over $200 million, but for the other two items, you don't provide any breakdowns. You just provide board power figures. And the most bewildering item is the police's operational base. At Chat Lap Kok Station, we should already have a operational base of the police and a special duties unit, right? I'm not going to argue with you on manpower. You say that with an additional runway, there is more manpower needed. You said it's an operational base. But then you talked about shooting range and training facilities. Why do you have to train people at the airport? Well, airport land is so precious. You said it's a standalone building with 8 stories. Well, this is something that you talked about, and you please don't repeat it. You said it will be built on a no-frill design. What is the site area of the operational base? And it would also incorporate training facilities. Do you have a breakdown for building the block alone? And why do you have to provide for training facilities? It's not like Sanok Lang Holding Center, where next to it there is a 19-hectare plot where training on counterterrorism will be carried out. Why are you carrying out training at the airport? Of the $3 billion, we are talking about 6 departments altogether. So I don't want to be impolite. I'm not asking about the $3 billion. We don't have sufficient time. I'm targeting or pinpointing $1.8 billion In terms of the site area, maybe the RTSD can help with taking that question. Thank you for your question, Ms. Mo. About the operational base, the site area is around 11,000 square meters. And the floor area, gross floor area, is around 19,700 square meters. Well, it's a sizable area. So are you going to build 8 floors? The site area is 11,000 square meters, and the GFA is 19,000. It's around 20,000 square meters for the GFA. I still don't get it. We are talking about operational base. So it should be an area for deployment and rest and so on. Why? Is there a driving range, a shooting range here? Do you plan to have a shooting training facilities indoor there? And also, can we have the breakdowns of these various facilities? When we go to the PWSC, we will give you the detailed information. So all $1.8 million will be spent on the block. Well, that covers everything on that operational base. Do we need that much? At Sanok Ling, you are already building a similar facility. Maybe you can read or look at the breakdown before you ask further questions. Ms. Lee, please. Maybe there is some misunderstanding. I will be very brief. I have got 3 points to make. First, for the airport district now, it is 20 years old. It was built in 1998. At that time, there was just one terminal building and two runways. In the past 2 decades, as pointed out by Mr. Zhang, there has been an increase in the passenger throughput, the air traffic movements, and the cargo throughput. But then there hasn't been any expansion of the police station in the past 20 years. And we have increased manpower by 14% over the past 20 years. And the place is rather saturated as filled to capacity. Second point, for the new operational base, maybe you have misunderstood a bit. It belongs to the airport district as well, and the special duties unit, all of its members, will be relocated to the operational base. And the dock, police dock unit, the intelligence section, and the traffic team will also be there. To enhance our operational efficiency and maximize the use of the site, we will also have the facilities for the bomb team. So we would like to guarantee that there is safety at the airport. The third point, you talk about the shooting range. Ms. Klun-Mo is very concerned about it. I hope that you can understand three things. First, for the special duties unit at the airport, there will be a shooting range for them. That's correct. What problems are we facing now? Because right now, there aren't enough training facilities, and there is a long queue there. And if they have to go and train up for shooting, they have to go through to three different places, one at the border, the other at the Hong Kong Island, and the third one is in Shamsheng Po. And traveling can be quite a hassle. Mr. Michael Look, thank you, Chairman. I would support the funding proposals because that is very much needed. I'm very concerned about the meteorological system, about the we are talking about $200 million. $271 million is not a substantial sum, but I would like to know more about the tendering process. Would you be taking out international tendering exercise? How can you attract international brands to come to submit their bids? And is it the case it would choose the lowest bid, or you would factor in the efficiency of the products, or even the after sale, the maintenance service, and so on and so forth? I would like to find out more about that. And then in the 3RS project, we understand that there is a need for a cargo transport. The labor unions are very unhappy with the reclamation situation. A number of foreign workers have been imported. So for these projects, we'll foreign workers be imported. There is no reason for you to do so now because there isn't enough work to go around in the construction sector now. So how can you ensure that the contractors will not import foreign workers? So Mr. Zhang, I will take the question on the workers. Then the observatory, we take the question on the meteorological systems. Now, for contractors supervised by the AHK and ourselves, we will give priority to local workers. And in 2018 and this year, we still have an import scheme because we're trying to bring in workers who are responsible for reclamation, which are difficult to secure in Hong Kong. So whenever similar workers are available locally, we will definitely give priority to local workers. We have told the same to the contractors. So Observatory, Hong Kong Observatory, can you take the question on the meteorological system? Ms. Lau, please. Yes, just speak to the mic. Thank you, member, for your question, and thank you, Chairman. Most of the systems or equipment are imported, and the Hong Kong Observatory will go by the Government Logistics Department's established practices to take our open tender. As to who will win the bid, well, the Government Logistics Department has certain rules governing that. We, of course, will be looking at the bidding price and also the supplier's track records, if any, and even also the efficiency of the systems proposed. So all these will be factored in, and then we will go for the optimum system or optimal system. So any follow-up? So the supplies list has to move ahead with the times. For example, a decade ago, you might use overseas brands mostly. But then now, would mainland suppliers be considered as well to be included in the contractors list so that they can also get to submit their bids? I'm not saying that we must procure overseas or mainland systems. What I'm stressing is that we should have a fair system. We just not adhered to just buying overseas systems in the past. Now, just like mobile phones now, we're not using so much overseas brands these days. We are also using mainland brands.
So will the list be updated from time to time, Ms. Lam? Yes, we keep updating our list, and we have mainland suppliers on the list as well. Mr. Jeremy Tam.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to know the number of police officers in the current police district OB. Ms. Lee, please. The number of police officers. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Tam. We have about 460. And with the commissioning of the third runway, what will be the expected level of manpower? Ms. Lee, do you have any estimate? What will be the additional number of police officers? The from 1,200 hectares, there will be another 650 hectares. That is, the size will be increased by 50%. So the freight and passenger traffic, as well as the number of departures and arrivals. No, I'm not asking about you that, the number of police officers. That means workload will increase. No, I'm asking. I'm not asking you about the size of the airport. I know that. And I'm asking, what will be the manpower level of the current OB from 460 to what? Well, she's wasting my time. Usually, I will allow a bit of overrun until you're happy, okay? Ms. Lee, a proportion? Well, with the increase in workload, manpower will be boosted correspondingly according to the increase in workload. So
You can roughly estimate the additional manpower based on the additional workload. So what is your estimate? I think the increase will be proportional to the increase in workload. So 460, another 50%. You don't even know the manpower in the future, and now you are talking about a big area. All right, what is the current, what is the size of your current OB? Which one? From the administration, ASD, please. The current APS has a site area of about 16,800 square meters. That is the floor area, the site area. And the floor area will be about 13,000. You're going to have an 8-story office block and 5-story barrack block. You told me that the site area will be 16,800 square meters. And then GFA is just 13,000 square meters. I'm talking about the current APS, the existing APS. Now let's refer to the plan to make it simple for you. Now this is the plan. You have a green box and a red box. Now the green box is the existing airport police station. What is the site area? What is the GFA? 13,000 square meters. All right, 460 occupants, 13,000 square meters. All right, you are not going to double your manpower, right? 68 flights per hour. In future, it'd be about 120. So manpower will be increased by 50%, another 200 odd. And how come the future size or GFA will be so big? All right. And you have a firing range inside that. I know you don't have time, but you have to give me a supplementary information paper telling us the schedule of accommodation in the 8-story office block, because we spend more than $100 billion on reclamation. Now, if you don't need all the size, all the land here, you should surrender some of the land for other users. Mr. Yu Siwing, the 3RS will be commissioned in a few years' time, and we will have a state-of-the-art airport in Hong Kong. I hope the resources and can be upgraded accordingly. So we should have the most advanced facilities and equipment. So I'd rather you over-provision than having to make up for the shortfall in the future. All right, the relevant facilities will be commissioned in 2023. Now by 2030, our HKIA might be saturated. Now if we need further expansion of the airport by then, will the facilities planned here be able to cope with a further expansion of the airport? Or will you have to apply for additional funding in the future? And for commercial private planes, from 2006 to 2016, we have seen a 5-fold increase during the period. We have in the industry serving pet traveling with pets, and it's found that our customs and immigration facilities cannot cope with
the needs of this industry. So in each plane, there can only be 10 pets. And the explanation we got is there aren't sufficient facilities in our customs. Can you expand the facilities of our customs and excise as well? Thank you. Regarding government facilities in the building, now we are making proposals for the 3RS. So we have a budget of $300 billion. There will be some expansion in the airport in the future, and we may have to seek more resources if $300 billion is exceeded. 10, 20 years down the road, the technology may be more advanced, and I may have to defer to the Customs and Excise and Immigration Departments to take the question about the pet traveling sector. We need inspection facilities. If they need that, we can try very best to accommodate. Any response from the AFCD regarding pet traveling? Dr. Ho, veterinary surgeon. Yes, we don't have adequate facilities for pet tourism because the berths for the planes will be a bit is a distance away from our facilities, and we for AFCD we have not made any facilities for private jets. I hope that in future, in 2030, we have more such facilities, and because of development of private jets, we need more immigration and customs facilities. Now, we want Hong Kong to be an international aviation hub, and I hope in this expansion of facilities, we can have more facilities for private commercial planes. Mr. Jeffrey Lam, thank you. For security in the airport, we must understand the actual situation, and there should be training on site. Mr. Jeremy Tam said that it's not necessary to provide training on site. Otherwise, we won't have to build so many swimming pools in Hong Kong. The athletes can just train elsewhere. I'd like to know whether the facilities have to be adjusted or upgraded. Because technology advances by leaps and bounds, is it true that by the time the facilities are commissioned, you can still adopt the same standards and in your plan now? Now, for meteorological equipment, in 2018, we obtained funding for civil engineering works. Hong Kong O is seeking $200 million for procurement of equipment. We don't want to tender so early because they would like to keep track
of the latest technology. Now, when funding is available now, they will go for state-of-the-art or the latest technology available in the market. So we're not too worried about being behind the latest development. But are you of the view that the level of technology is sufficient? We believe so. Mr. Kenneth Low, my question relates to the OB. For that $1.8 billion is just for construction and design. What about fittings and fixtures and IT and security systems? Are they included in this $1.8 billion? And on the question of a firing range, I'd like to know whether it is an indoor facility like what we see in the Olympic Games. If it is an open air firing range, then this is a waste of the reclaimed land, because the reclaimed land is very precious. That $1.8 billion include all the facilities, and as far as I understand, the firing range is an indoor one. So it will be housed in the same building as the office block. It is not an outdoor firing range. All right. Now, on this map, we can see green as well as a red building. Can you confirm that for the orange OB, the green APS will continue to operate, and the orange OB will not replace the green APS? And for the airport district, I'd like to know whether it is under the islands region. Is there any plan to upgrade the airport district with the commissioning of a 3RS? And I do not see a scale for this plan. What is the distance between the green and the orange boxes?
Mr. Chang, let me take the question first. As far as we understand, the orange and green parts will exist at the same time, and there will be internal refurbishment of the existing APS, and will still continue to operate even after the new OB is commissioned. What about the distance between the two? Yes, I know it's at the right bottom corner. It's around 1 point something. Ms. Lee, there are two operation bases, the green and the orange part. So the different formations will be working at these two different locations. The structure of the airport district, how to cope with the work in the future? We believe that going forward, we will increase manpower, and the aim is to maintain the law and order of the airport and ensure aviation safety. And in reviewing the manpower needs, can you clarify for the airport district, does it belong to the island region and it reports to the assistant commissioner, or the command, or the commander will report to somebody else, or will there be a change in the future? Is part of the NT South now, and there is an assistant director in charge of the NT South now, and the airport district is subsumed under the NT South, and the island region is another region next to the NT South. Mr. Ronick Chan, I would like to ask something about the finances of the 3RS. Now, concerning the procurement of the meteorological system, the initial estimate is $271.9 million, and the breakdown is set down in in Annex 2. And then in 2021, the recurrent expenditure is $1.1 million, which will progressively increase to $14.5 million in the future. So what are the breakdowns here? Is it manpower? And in 4 years, it will increase by 13 times. How come that the increase will accelerate towards the end of that four-year period? And then the government says that it will go by the user pay principle, and it will recover all the costs from the AHK and the airplane companies. And then there will be en route navigation charges and ATC service charges to be imposed on airlines. So have you made an estimate on the total sum recovered, and how long will it take to recover all the costs? Let me answer the question on the user pays principle. There are two parts. If the aircraft lands in Hong Kong and through the AHK, the aviation weather service charge will be handed to the AHK. And for aircraft overflying Hong Kong, the charge will be levied on the airlines companies. We don't have the information on the recovery of the cost, and if needed, we can provide the information later. Hong Kong Observatory. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. The recurrent cost covers the spare parts and components, and also the contract maintenance cost. Why is it $1.1 million initially and then gradually rise to $14.5 million? Now, as equipment begins operation, then we need contract maintenance on these equipment. So that's enhanced the increase. And that includes manpower costs as well. Another question, Chairman. There are two other public works projects costing $3.025 million and $1.866 million, and these will be entrusted to the AHK for build and management. And there is no recurrent cost spelled out for these two public works projects. Is it the case that the recurrent cost is not included in the entrustment agreement yet? And then is it the case that after the projects have been completed and the entrustment agreement is signed, then you will come to seek funding for the recurrent costs at the LegCo then? Now, that has nothing to do with the rent entrustment agreement. We have to entrust the AHK to do the works. And that the entrustment cost has been included in the $3 billion or $1.8 billion. Now, as for the entrustment cost, it will be included in the paper to be submitted to the PWSC. The recurrent cost will be included in the paper. The estimates will be included in the PWSC paper to be further submitted later. Mr. Wu Chiu-wai, second round. Thank you, Chairman. My question is very simple. There will be around 20,000 square meters in the new in GFA in the operation base, and there will be there is 13,000 square meters in the old operational base now. Now, the old operation base has been in use for 20 years, and for the new operational base, it is situated between the new and the old runway, and it can support both runways. It's an ideal location, and that is efficient and cost-effective when it comes to the police's discharging its commands. So have you considered combining the two into one and just have one location so that the commands can be made more efficiently? In other words, there would be just one operational base to issue commands to places all over the airport. It's better to have two different locations, I believe. Can I ask the police to take that question? Thank you, Mr. Wu. You are talking about the orange and the green parts. You think the location of the orange part is box is not ideal, is that right? Well, the orange box is strategically located. We have thought through this already. It can make up for the shortfall in the space of the old police station. Well, you've misunderstood me. I think the orange location is very ideal. It is just right between the old and the new runway, and it's between the new and the old passenger building. So have you considered putting everything in the orange spot? This is the new operational base. Well, four major units of the district of the airport district will be placed there, and it will also respond to emergency situations. The green box is the existing APS. As I said, the APS carries out daily duties, including patrolling the airport, dealing with inquiries made by users of airport, assistant other stakeholders to enforcing bylaws. As I said, the new operational base will make up for the shortfalls of the APS, because in the new orange location, there will be the special duties unit, police dock unit, traffic team, intelligence section, and the bombs and explosives section will also be added. You haven't answered my question. Can the orange spot be turned into an integrated operational base dealing with everything at the airport district? Let me take your question, Mr. Wu. Let's look at the location of the orange spot. It comes with a height restriction, airport height restriction. And the AAHK has told us that we are already maximizing the height there. And for the footprint of the site has also been put to the maximum use. Well, unless we increase the site, then nothing else can be added. So only when we build a higher building can we have just one spot instead of two. The footprint is 10,000 square meters, and the block will be 8 stories high. So I don't think the space is limited there. So my query all along is that can we combine the green and the orange locations? So if you have not thought about it, please consider thinking about it. And if you have already considered it, just tell me so. Mr. Kenneth Lang, just two questions. The police, can you give us some information as to what other international airports have adopted this two-location model for police's operations? Is there any other major airport doing that? And then second question, do you have plans to build the GFS headquarters at the airport, the Government Flying Services headquarters? It's a very dilapidated and a small headquarters. It's running short of space. Can the police's representative help out? Have you taken reference from international experience? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Leung, for your question. First, for the Hong Kong International Airport, it is an important infrastructure. Compared to other international airports, our scale, our geographical location may be different from other international airports. So a direct comparison cannot be made. You asked whether there is a similar practice in which, whereby there are two units or two offices or two working locations for the police at the airport. I believe that there are indeed such arrangements in other places, but we still just have one police district. It's just that we've got another working location in the green spot, in the orange spot. The aim is to
to respond to or to cater to the increasing needs. Well, what about Heathrow Airport? How many police stations? Well, there are four terminals at Heathrow Airport. Are there so two or three operational bases at that airport? Can you ask them for the information? Can we make a comparison with Heathrow? I don't have the information on hand. We can supply the information later. What about the GFS? We don't have any plans to rebuild the GFS headquarters. We haven't received any information in that regard. So if members don't have any further questions, I don't believe that we will object to this proposal. Mr. Wu Chi-wai? I hope that the administration and the police can provide more detailed information. Well, if we just have the information in this paper, I will not agree to the proposal. We can discuss that at the PWSC further. Well, you know that very often there can never be any thorough discussion at the PWSC. Do we need to put that to a vote? Mr. Yu Si-wing, yes, I support this. Well, if somebody objects to it, let's put this to the vote. Do we have to have the bell rung? Okay, let's have the bell rung for 5 minutes. Please switch on Mr. Wu Chi-wai's microphone. Because the paper covers a bundle of projects, and among them, I have views on the police's arrangement, and i.e. the matter related to the orange sport. So I just object to this particular issue here, or particular matter here.
May
I remind members that we are voting on the resources proposal relating to the government facilities and equipment to support the three runway system in Hong Kong IA. We are voting on whether we support the submitting the funding proposals to PWSC and FC.
Okay, 现在开始表决.
Voting begins. All right, before I announce the results, can you please check your votes? All right, voting is closed. The results are shown here. 8-4-5 against and 0 abstention. So the proposals are approved. All right, thank you very much, government team. And we move on to the fifth item, 2020 electricity tariff review and electricity charges subsidy for non-residential customers. Please invite the officials and representatives from the two power companies to join us now. The administration will brief us on electricity charges subsidy for non-residential customers, and the two power companies will give PowerPoint presentations on their 2020 electricity tariff review. All right, please press the request to speak button if you intend to ask questions. Mr. Wong Kam Sing, Secretary for the Environment, and representatives from the two power companies. I will skip the formal introductions. Before the secretary speaks, there is a written question from Mr. Xu Ka Chen asking for a written reply from the administration. So I will pass on this written question from Mr. Xu to the secretary later. I will give the floor to the secretary first. Before I invite representatives from HKE and CLP to speak, may I remind representatives from the two power companies that your submissions here will not be protected by the Electrical Powers and Privileges Ordinance, CAP 328 of Hong Kong legislation. Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. My opening address will be divided into three parts. First, under the scheme of control agreement, the government has completed the 2020 annual tariff review of the two power companies in setting the tariffs for next year. This year's exercise is challenging. On the one hand, we want to protect our environment. On the other hand, we have to achieve the power or the fuel mix targets. And so both companies have to use natural gas for power generation, and this is more expensive, and the economy will also affect the projected power consumption next year, and therefore the review has to take into account various factors and the situation next year. On the same occasion last year, the government had the support and understanding of this panel. Starting from January 2019, we've been giving relief to domestic or residential users. We provide up to $3,000 in relief to be released in 16 months. So on average, each residential consumer
will enjoy $50 of relief per month. This year, we are committed to negotiating with the two power companies, hoping that the level of review will be mild. And we also encourage the two power companies to provide relief to different sectors of the community, the SMEs in particular, to tide over the difficult period. And the government has also launched relief measures to help our community. As announced in August this year, we provide $2,000 in subsidy to each non-residential consumer. And then the FS announced on the 4th of December that SMEs will be entitled to a relief to cover 75% of the billed electricity charges, subject to a cap of $5,000 per month, and that would mean $2.3 billion of government money. And this is a relief for non-residential customers as part of the four rounds of relief measures to help different sectors of the community to tackle the downturn in our economy. And we have already submitted a paper to this panel on this proposal. With your blessing, we will apply for funding support from the FC. And then for the review, this year we have also reviewed the feed-in tariff. We would like to provide sufficient financial incentives for the use of renewable energy and taking into account these factors. We propose to maintain the same level of feed-in tariff at $3 to $5 so as to support the use of renewable energy in society. So I will now give the floor to HKE and CLP to brief you on their tariff proposals. Dr. KK Kwok, can we be given the Secretary's speaking note? Do you have a speaking note for your address? If you do, please have it photostated to members. Please do so, Secretary. All right, which one from the two power companies will speak first? Hong Kong Electric. Mr. C.T. Wen. Thank you. In order to support government's policies to reduce carbon emission, we have to use more natural gas for power generation. And so the fuel cost will increase as a result. In the past 3 years, Hong Kong has provided two large amounts of special rebates. We return special rents and rates rebate to the government. In 2019, the two rebate total 4.6 cents per unit in the last 3 years, and so the balance is much depleted. So next year we cannot provide the same extent of special rebates, and this will be reflected in the electricity bill starting from next year at once. So we have to raise our basic tariff by 6.3 cents per unit, and that is 5.2%. However, if we remove the effect of the two rebates, the actual increase is just 1.7%. So after adjustment, the tariff will just be around the same level of what it was 10 years ago, abate and 30% increase in inflation over the same period. We have taken into account the impacts of the recent social incidents on our customers, the SMEs in particular. So we will launch a series of measures to help to alleviate that burden.
For instance, we will waive the tariff increase for some consumers for the first 6 months of this year, and we will also provide cash coupon for underprivileged families for use at SME eateries. We believe our measures will help to lower the burden of power consumption, and we believe the overall electricity expenses will be lower than what it is for this year. And about 30% of the residential customers will not have to pay any electricity tariff. And then I will give the floor to my colleague to give you details of our proposals. Thank you. Mr. Wen has already highlighted the salient points of our tariff review for next year. The government has launched three relief measures for electricity consumption, and the Secretary has already outlined that to you. Hong Kong Yi will also provide similar measures. We will provide grace period so that around 70,000 non-residential customers will have the tariff increase waived for the first 6 months of next year. And we'll also provide energy efficient equipment subsidy. Now for SMEs, we can allow them to apply for 2 month payment deferral of electricity charges for December and January next year. And then we also have a cash coupon scheme. Underprivileged families will be given $500 worth of cash coupons for use at SME restaurants. And then we will have funding for NGO activities. Each will be granted $60,000 to organize catering activities for people in need so as to generate business for SME caterers. The net tariff before special rebates will be 1.7%. However, the overall rebates will be cut to only 4% per unit, and therefore the net tariff after special rebates will be 5.2% increase. Now first, we removed the two special rebates, and so tariff will rise by 4.6 cents and other 0.7% plus 1.4 cents in fuel clause charge and less 0.4 cents in special rent and rates rebate. And because of the reduction in rates, the net tariff increase will be 126.4 cents per unit.
Now let's take a look at what happens after the government's relief measures have come into place. Now, over 45% of the customers will not need to pay any tariff next year. If a household using 1,000 units of electricity will pay $100 less. So all in all residential customers will be paying less next year for non-residential tariff. So for those using 15,000 units, they would be paying $4,000 less. So all electricity users will be paying less next year. Now for HKE, our tariff is still lower than those in other international cities. The proportion of gas generation will increase to 50% next year, and there will be a reduction in major emissions next year as well. We will also go ahead with the feed-in tariffs, RE certificate initiatives, and other smart power services and associated programs to enhance energy efficiency and save energy in the future. All in all, the net tariff is adjusted to 126.4 cents. And if the rebates are excluded, the adjustment will be 1.7% only, and is comparable to that in 2011. And it is much lower than the cumulative inflation rate in the past 10 years. So much for my presentation. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Yu. Now, can we invite the representative from the CLP to take us through your paper, please? Mr. Chang, thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman members. Hong Kong is now facing grave challenges, and to help everybody tide over the difficulties, we will be deploying $200 million in 2020 to launch a number of difficulties so that we can tide through the difficulties with people of the Hong Kong. So we'll be allocating $150 million for SMEs, and $55 million will be devoted to help people in need, the disadvantaged groups, students in need, and $7 million will be used to help SDU tenants, and $10 million will be used to help people living in transitional housing. Through such programs, we hope to help people in need to tide over the difficult times, and we hope that everybody can join us in our efforts so that Hong Kong's economy can rebound. Now, Mr. Luo, my colleague, will explain the 2020 tariff. Thank you, Mr. Luo. Thank you. Next, I will be explaining the details of the 2020 tariff review. On the 1st of January 2020, there will be an increase of 1.2 cents for every unit. And we will be also be distributing rent and rates rebate of 1.2 cents per unit. And after offsetting these two items, and that is to say the basic tariff will remain unchanged in 2020, and that is 91 cents. And starting next year, we have to use more natural gas, which is more expensive. The proportion of natural gas will increase from 29% to 50%. So the fuel cost will be adjusted upwards by 3 cents to 30.8 cents. So after the adjustment, is the tariff per unit is 1.21.8 cents, a rise of 2.5%. Now, the government and the CRB has used various ways to reduce the pressure on upward adjustment of tariffs. The residential units will benefit from the government's two relief measures, and the subsidy will offset the increase in the fuel cost in 2020 for SMEs, and the CLP will use the Community Energy Saving Fund to subsidize the 320,000 SMEs. They will be subsidized in the first half of next year, and the relief measures implemented by the government will drive down the electricity bill of SMEs. We would like to dovetail with the government's environmental policies. We'll use more natural gas, which is more expensive than coal, but it can help reduce markedly the carbon emission. In 2020, the carbon intensity of electricity will be reduced from 0.5 kg unit to 0.4 kg per unit, a reduction of 20% in 2020. So from the diagram, you can see that compared to Japan, Germany, we are doing better. And our electricity, our tariff is even lower than theirs. And so the emission reduction results are very apparent. And that is to say, we are planting over 50 trees per customer. And that is to say, we are planting over 100 million trees all over Hong Kong. And last but not least, I would like to sum up the several programs of CLP, which are aimed to tide over the difficult times with the SMEs and the Hong Kong public. And for the 320,000 SMEs, we will provide a six-month subsidy amounting to $150 million. And we will earmark $20 million to launch a four-month restaurant coupon program. And 100,000 households will be given $200 each. And they can use these coupons in participating restaurants to stimulate spending in restaurants. And $7 million will be set aside to benefit subdivided units which cannot benefit from the government one of relief measures. And 10,000 households will benefit. And we will continue to subsidize SDU
owners to rewire their cables and to install independent or separate meters. And $25 million will be set aside to continue rolling out the Power Connect to provide $500 subsidy to 30,000 households. And through promotion programs, we would also encourage households to save energy. And $10 million will also be set aside for students in need to enroll in vocational schools so that their careers can be enhanced. And then $10 million will be spent over 3 years to donate smart electrical appliances for those living in transitional housing. We hope that we can get your support in all these initiatives. Thank you very much. Right now, 7 members have pressed the button to speak. So 4 minutes each. First is Mr. Ronick Chan, followed by Dr. Kwakaki. Thank you, Chairman. We understand that we should use greener fuel, which might drive up fuel costs. But then in economic downturn situation, an increase in tariff will be a burden to all households. We welcome these two companies to launch relief or subsidy measures. And some of them are actually covering a wide section of the community, like what the government does. And the government has rolled out 2 relief measures for residential users. But then for non-residential users, you are launching a 4-month program giving subsidy of $5,000 per month, subject to 75% of their billed electricity charges. But for small enterprises, they may enjoy the subsidy to the fullest. But then for SMEs who do not use a lot of electricity, such relief may not be very effective for them and may not benefit them the most. So the government may consider asking for information from the 2 power companies on the non-residential electricity users. And for those which use little electricity, maybe you can subsidize 100%. And you can have a tiered subsidy program. Maybe you can seek the relevant information from the 2 power companies so that you can refine your program further. On the contrary, for, say, residential households and non-residential households. And since you have a subsidy, perhaps the households are incentivized to use more electricity. So will you consider doing more, encouraging them to save conservation so that your subsidy will not, on the reverse, encourage them to use more electricity? So thank you for your question. Of course, we have to be environmentally friendly. We have to conserve energy. And at the same time, we have to be mindful about the current situation in the society. So that's why we set a certain ratio, and there is a co-payment. And we're not subsidizing everyone 100%. The non-residential users still are asked to pay a certain percentage so that there will not be a waste of the electricity or abuse of the system. So that's why we want to save energy, and at the same time, we take into consideration the current economic situation. Secondly, we want to implement a speedy and convenient scheme to help the non-residential users and the SMEs. So the way we approach it is rather straightforward. But going forward, is there room for further refinement? Of course, that is subject to further discussion and consideration. We know that the caterers are bearing the brunt now, and they use quite a substantial amount of electricity. So we are implementing this program, helping to subsidize 75% of their electricity bill. For other SMEs not in the catering industry, they may not be enjoying as much as their catering counterparts. But in any case, you want to roll out a program as fast as possible, which works simply, in a simple way, and that's our consideration. Dr. KK Kwok, thank you, Chairman. The two power companies are actually benefiting from all the atrocities committed by the government. The CLP is asking for an increase of 5.2%. Our inflation rate is just 2.6% last year. And because of the extrajudicial bill incident, so the power companies are asking for a high tariff increase. 5.2% is larger or higher than the inflation rate. And that is problem created by the government. When the SEAs were signed last year, the government had made sure that the two power companies can earn a certain profit. And this year, they are using relief and subsidy measures to help out with the to help the two power companies. And the two power companies have not made efforts to improve themselves. The CLP has been increasing the ratio of gas in generating electricity, and their fuel costs is higher than that of electricity costs because they use the west to east transmission system. They don't know how to save money, and they are buying very expensive gas, and their tariff increase has been offset to a certain extent by the government's relief measures. And we are in fact using public funds to subsidize the two power companies. So we are talking about $3.5 billion for Hong Kong E and $10 billion for CLP. So because of your relief measures, the two power companies can still raise tariffs. So are you not doing this injustice to Hong Kong people?
Now for the CLP, their fuel costs are so high. Have you really queried the CLP and asked them to do better? For slide number 5 of HKE, now last year there was quite a high level of special rents and rates rebate. And so if we discount that, the net tariff increase before special rebates is only 1.7%. And we want to encourage the two power companies to use natural gas and the liquefied natural gas refilling station will be commissioned very soon, and we can diversify our sources of natural gas. Now, you know full well that CLP is buying expensive natural gas. Have you done anything to address that? Well, there is a professional involvement in the negotiation. I have nothing more to add. Well, I still have time. The two power companies can supplement. All right, anyone from the power companies? Can CLP explain why it has continued to buy expensive gas? The source of natural gas, well, CLP buys natural gas from various sources. In 2008, the Central People's Government and the Hong Kong SAR government signed a memorandum of understanding on the supply of natural gas. That means the SAR government and the Central People's Government have caused you to buy expensive natural gas. So the contract of transmitting gas from the mainland to Hong Kong, and that contract or that agreement will last 20 years. That is, thanks to the Hong Kong SAR government, you have to buy expensive natural gas. Well, the prices of natural gases may be different depending on the time and also the source. But what you get is more expensive. Well, because the contracts were signed at different times, so there cannot be a direct comparison of prices. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Mr. Wong, Secretary, I hope you can face up to this. because the fuel mix will have to comply with requirements under AQO. They will have to commission an other gas generating plant or unit. Under the scheme of control agreement, for new capital, there can be a guaranteed rate of return at 8%. When we have more gas generating unit, two variables will continue to jack up tariffs. First, amount of capital investment, because capital investment will ensure an 8% rate of return. And gas is more expensive than coal, no matter how you do the calculation. So electricity tariffs are bound to increase continuously. Given the situation, what strategy does the government have? Will you spend $8.2 billion in subsidy every time to offset tariff increase so that the public will not notice? Or will the government pay for the capital investment of the two power companies so that they won't be given a guaranteed rate of return of 8%? Instead, can the government invest into their capital expenditure on our behalf? In the long term, it can help to moderate electricity tariff increase from the two power companies.
Thank you. I understand Mr. Wu Chi-wai's concern. I think Mr. Wu knows very well our energy policy. We want to ensure stability in tariff, and the tariff must also be reasonable. And therefore, I am proposing a solution to you. Whenever there are tariff increases, you offset it by means of $8.2 billion. I'm asking whether you can discuss with the power companies. You procure some of the new assets, such as gas generating units, gas power generation units. And for instance, for the reception facilities of natural gas, both companies have to use that. Can we use public resources to buy them so that they will not become part of the company's average net fixed assets, which will have a permitted rate of return of 8%? Now, compared to large cities, our tariffs, our level of tariffs are very reasonable. So you consider that it is right for our tariffs to continue to rise. Well, we have to ensure that our tariffs are maintained at a reasonable level, and we're using different measures. Well, will you consider my suggestion? Please do not allow their effort to continue to accumulate. You can buy some of their assets so that in the long run, we can help to contain our tariff increase. Well, for the liquefied natural gas reception facilities, it will help us to diversify our sources of natural gas so that we can relieve the future pressure for tariff increase. Mr. Michael Look, well, members of the public want clean air, and the government dictates natural gas
for power generation. And as a result, tariffs will be higher and people feel aggrieved. The secretary may think that we are being contradictory. On the one hand, we want clean air and we don't want high tariffs. Now, do you see the heading of CLP here? Together through difficult times. Chairman, you're from the business sector. What a business can give you a return of 8% nowadays? I think it's not easy. They are protected by the scheme of control agreements. They have a permitted rate of return of 8%. I'd like to ask the two companies, must you make the most of your profits? Can you have some conscience given the difficult times in Hong Kong now? Can you not raise tariffs to the maximum extent? Although the government has introduced relief measures to offset their increases, as a result, the public will not notice the tariff increases. The relief measures are supposed to help the public. In effect, it has some help to protect the two power companies, and the public may not know the extent of tariff increases. And the gas-fired generation units will be updated from time to time. And that means the assets will continue to increase. Can you try to suppress their growth in such plants and also growth in ENFA? Yes. Many of the coal-fired generating units were built many times ago, many years ago, and some of them can no longer be used. So they are replacing the old units and with gas-generated or gas-fired generation units. Must they raise electricity tariffs given the difficult times we have in Hong Kong now? Can the two power companies tell us whether you can not maximize your profits? Mr. Wen? Thank you, Chairman. The new scheme of control agreement just started in 2019. And you may recall that the rate of return has dropped from 9.9% to 8% and a drop of 20% this year. So it's not that we have not help the public at this difficult time. We have taken a major step to share the burden of the public. Now, for our coal-fired generation units, some of them are close to 3 decades old. And if they need to be replaced, and in order to reduce emission and carbon, I think what we do now is a win-win solution. So replacing the coal with gas-fired electricity generation units is a win-win situation. We can benefit both the community and ourselves. Can you please respond to the point made by Mr. Michael Look? Thank you. CLP understands that we face stiff challenges. And so we have deployed over $200 million with different measures to help different sectors of the community, hoping that we can ride out the storm together with the community. We have to use 50%, or we have to use natural gas for 50% of our fuel,
and we have to spend another $2 billion on this as a result. So the pressure on tariff review is mainly because of what we spend on natural gas. Thank you. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, in the past decade or so, because of climate change and the community's aspirations for carbon reduction, the government and the power companies had engaged the public in several rounds of public consultation. The balance, the pros and cons of different types of fuel, and there is a consensus in society that we should increase the use of natural gas for power generation. Since they have opted for natural gas, some power generation units have to be updated or replaced, and this kind of fuel is also more costly. I think we do understand that electricity tariffs will rise as a result of this fuel mix. But of course, we all feel the impact, and we want the companies to enhance their efficiency. And we would also want to offset the impacts of rising costs. The two power companies have announced a number of relief measures, and because we face difficulties both internally and externally, and the government has announced relief measures for both domestic and non-domestic users, and they've also taken on board our proposals, and they are going to extend the subsidy to non-residential customers at up to $5,000 per customer. Of course, we are spending public money to provide such relief.
But in the long run, we need, as far as the supply of natural gas is concerned, what measures can we do to increase the supply? We've heard about the offshore LNG terminal, and if we've got that kind of storage model, we have a lot more flexibility in procuring natural gas, and it also enhances our bargaining power. So how are we going to proceed with this further in the future? We should not just focus on next year. We should also be looking at the long-term scenario. How can we use clean energy and at the same time cut down the cost? Who would take that question, please? Mr. Wen.
Thank you, Chairman. For the offshore liquefied natural gas terminal, it is a project jointly worked on by the two power companies. We would like to increase the supply of natural gas. For Hong Kong E, right now, 32% of our power comes from natural gas, and next year, it will increase to 50%. And right now, the natural gas comes from Shenzhen, Daipang Bay, and we've got only one pipeline, and if 50% is transmitted through that single pipeline, is quite risky. But if we have the offshore LNG terminal, then the supply can be guaranteed. And then if you have just one supplier, then you don't have any bargaining power. So if we have the offshore LNG terminal, then we can source from different suppliers all over the world. So we can have guarantees to the supply. And also, we can also source cheaper natural gas as well. So we can be guaranteed in our supply, and we can also enjoy lower prices as well. Dr. Lo, I'm just asking about the updated progress of the project. Can you brief us on this? The progress has been very good. According to our projection, By the end of 2021, the project will be commissioned. So in the interest of time, if you don't have any further questions, I'll just draw a line here. Mr. Yu Siwing. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to follow up on the West to East transmission program. In 2008, what was the reason for launching this project? Because the cost was quite expensive. And maybe CLP is using more of the gas supply from the West to East transmission program. You referred to the liquefied natural gas. What is the percentage of LNG used by the CLP? Because the lower your cost, the lower will the tariff be to the users. Next question is about the cash coupons. I support issuing coupons because the retail and the catering sectors in Hong Kong face tremendous pressure. The two companies, power companies, has different approaches. Hong Kong Electric offers $500, CLP $200. Can you standardize it? Because there's no reason why the amount should be different in Hong Kong Island and Kowloon. So can it be standardized to $500? And also, please allow it to be used not only in the catering industry, it can also be used in retail sector and tourism sector. I hope that we can join hands to help people to tide over the difficulties now. Can you standardize the amount to $500, Mr. Zhang? Let me respond to the first two questions first. About the West to East transmission program, in 2008, the central government and the SAR government signed a memorandum of understanding an energy cooperation, setting out that new gas supply will be coming from the mainland. And the second line of that program was the only ways to satisfy Hong Kong needs fastest. So we signed an agreement lasting for 20 years. Going forward, the ratio of natural gas will further go up. Like I said, in the South China Sea, there will be oil fields supplying new source of natural gas. And together with the Hong Kong E, we will also build an offshore LNG terminal. The initial design was completed, and a tendering exercise is now being taken out to identify the contractor, and it will be completed by the end of 2021. As more natural gas is being used in the future, the use of the natural gas will be affected by a number of factors, including our own consumption demand, the international prices. So it's very difficult now to give you a fixed ratio right now. What about standardizing the amount to $500 and also the coverage or the usage of the cash coupons? There are two aims to the cash coupons. First, we hope to stimulate more people to have social activities. And dining is a way to encourage social interaction and activities. And also the catering industry has been hardest hit because of the social unrest. So we hope to benefit both parties under this cash discount cash coupon program. So we try to maximize the number of beneficiaries. So that's why we set the amount at $200 to benefit the most number of households. Mr. Holden Chow. What about Hong Kong Electric? Can you consider extending the usage of the cash coupons, including dining, retail, and tourism? Can you do that? And Mr. Holden Chow, thank you, Chairman. There is another meeting going on in the next room. So if I'm asking a question which has been raised by others, please be accommodating. Because of the more heavy usage of natural gas, the fuel cost will will go up, and one by 6.3 cents, the other by 3 cents for the two companies. The social turmoil has dealt a heavy blow to the economy, and the grassroots are very worried. The net tariff has gone up. Can the two power companies tell us that since the government has launched relief measures, and just now the FCA has approved a subsidy of $2,000 for each household, and then there is another relief measure endorsed earlier about giving subsidy of $50 for each household. Now, after all these relief measures have been factored in, what is your take of the burden on the households? How much help will these relief measures lend to the households in terms of the tariff, the burden on tariff? And the CLP also mentioned that there will be support to SDU tenants to the tune of $7 million benefiting 10,000 households. How is the amount distributed or allocated among the 10,000 households? How can you how would you identify these 10,000 households? The two power companies have mentioned what your consensus are. Anyway, can the two power companies answer again, Mr. Ho and Chao's questions? Mr. Wen, thank you, Mr. Chao, for your question. You referred to the increase in the tariff. For HKE, the tariff rise is 5.2% or 6.3 cents. The majority of it has to do with the special rebates. In the past 3 years, we have enjoyed a substantial amount of special rebates. One has to do with the rebates of the excessive rent and rates charged on us by the government, and the other has to do with the remaining balance in the fuel cost account. And in the past 3 years, we have rebated around $5 billion to our customers. So we can just rebate 0.4 cents this year. So in 2019, we could rebate 4.6 cents. Now we can only rebate 4 cents, and that takes up 3.5%. So if we deduct 3.5% from the 5.2%, it would just be 1.7%, which is lower than the inflation rate. And this rate is even lower than that stipulated in the 5-year development plan. So we have exercised the most restraint in coming up with this new tariff. Are we providing relief measures to people in Hong Kong? There are 5 relief measures. Well, we call it 3+2 relief measures. For non-residential customers, especially the SMEs, some 70,000 SMEs we'll have the tariff increase, i.e. 5% increase, for 2020 waived for the 6 months in early 2020. That is the first measure. And then for energy-saving facilities or equipment, say, for example, if a customer has some old electrical appliance which is not energy efficient, we'll help them replace such equipment, and every household will be given $50,000 to $150,000 to do that. And then thirdly, we allow deferred payment of electricity charges, especially for catering establishments. They can defer their payments of electricity charges for December 2019, January 2020. And then there is a cash coupon scheme. Every household in need will be given $500 worth of cash coupons, and they can use them at catering businesses who are partners. Actually, the two papers have said that those out very clearly. We have extended our meeting time by 10 minutes, and we still have two more members who would like to ask a question. Mr. Eddie Zhu.
Thank you, Chairman. I know that many colleagues will talk about the very grave economic situation, and they ask for a lower tariff increase and more help to be given to the grassroots. My question would be on emission reduction. Just now, Mr. Michael Look said something which is very worrying. It seems that some legislators still do not know that emission reduction and carbon reduction is not just to provide for cleaner air. We want to cut down on greenhouse emission, or else we'll end up in major disasters. If members still do not know about this, then it goes to show that the government really faces great difficulties in educating the public on the issue. I understand that for the long-term carbon reduction strategy, three scenarios have been mentioned. The most aggressive scenario is that by 2050, there will be zero emission. And next year, there will be COP26 to be held in England. And the people will be asked to drop a roadmap towards 2050 after the Paris Agreement was signed.
When we issue the consultation outcome of the strategy, I believe it will not be later than the summit in England next year. All right, for the three scenarios mapped out by the administration, I'd like to ask the two power companies whether they have conducted any study separately on the feasibility of achieving the three scenarios, the respective costs and also strategies. Have you submitted any study to the administration so that it has the basis for making a judgment and make a choice on behalf of the community? Because I think there are a lot of chain reactions forcing us to achieve zero emission by 2050. Yes, so will the administration, will the secretary or the two power companies respond? First, the long-term strategy for carbon reduction and our progress. We want to map out a strategy for carbon emission reduction all the way to the middle of this century. We have invited the two power companies to join us in this consultation, and public engagement ended in last September. What we are doing now is collating views we've received, and then we will have a report very soon. I think she has wasted 30 seconds of my time. My question was whether the two power companies have studied how or whether they could achieve the most aggressive scenario of the government. She was talking nonsense.
Mr. Chair,
we have not done any detailed study. We have read the government's consultation document and done our own analysis. In the short to medium term, we are using natural gas to replace coal in power generation. The former has less carbon emission than the latter, but of course not zero. if we want to replace coal altogether, we need to use new technology and also a carbon capture to achieve that. To attain such an aggressive carbon reduction target, we have to increase the use of zero carbon fuel that can be done by means of nuclear power and renewable energy. And of course, people have views on the use of nuclear energy. We will have to consult our customers, and then we will also try to cooperate with the government if it has any targets. Hong Kong E, have you done any study? Now, our surface area is just Hong Kong Island. As we all know, land is very limited on Hong Kong Island. Now, when it comes to carbon capture, I think is impossible. We've only got 7 kilometers square in area, and I think even if we use the whole of Hong Kong Island for land for renewable energy, that would hardly be sufficient for customers on Hong Kong Island. And I think this is not an issue we can address unilaterally. The government may have to take the lead and consider doing this in Hong Kong, and as a company alone, I don't think we can. I don't think we can really make any suggestions in this regard, Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Yes, we should increase the use of natural gas in our fuel mix. We should have more such generators, and we should achieve zero emission. I think this is already on our blueprint. My question for the Secretary is, because of our targets, tariffs are bound to increase. To resolve this problem, we can only have two options. One, the community will have to accept that even the community have to accept that tariffs are going to rise anyway, although they are still much lower than other cities. Second, because we may have new power generators, if they are to be included in the capital accounts of the two power companies, they'll be entitled to a rate of return of 8%. So I'm asking whether you have discussed with the two power companies. This is just like what Mr. Wen said. If the government would like to address air quality dip in a macro, at a macro level, then it has to deploy new strategies. New assets should not be owned by the power companies anymore. Rather, they should be investment by the government so that we can have improvement in air quality, in carbon reduction, and the government can invest in helping to offset global warming. So, do you have any intention to take out newly added assets from the two power companies so that they will no longer be entitled to an 8% rate of return? Secretary, as said by some members, on the one hand, we want to protect the environment, we want to reduce carbon emission, and we have set up a sustainable development council, and they will tell us what the public want, covering factors such as covering economic, financial factors, and how to protect the environment.
Yes, I've read the consultation document. The direction in the document is we should use clean fuel more and more. That means we may have to procure more clean fuel from the mainland, and we have to ensure that tariffs will not continue to rise. That is one strategy. Another strategy is we rely on, we attach significance to security in power supply. We want to generate our own power in Hong Kong so that we don't have to rely on power supply from the mainland. My question is whether you are willing to own new assets of the power companies, because you have signed a 15-year scheme of control agreement. I'd like to know whether there is room to explore this area. Well, since you are subsidizing the power companies anyway, have you considered using the same money to buy some of the assets so as to offset some of the tariff increases? I understand Mr. Wu's question. Come next year, we'll be able to learn about the outcome of the public consultation, and we welcome suggestions from different sectors. And I think it will be more appropriate for us, for me to give a consolidated reply. Will you consider my suggestion in your reply? And in your 15-year scheme of control agreement, are you allowed to do so? Well, that involves the contractual agreement. Well, the government has signed scheme of control agreements with the two power companies. I'd like to know whether there is any room for you to do that. Is that a yes or no? Well, next year we have the opportunity to look at the outcome of public consultation. The Council for Sustainable Development will then tell us what the public want, and the Environment Bureau will then be able to tell. Well, if the consultation is biased from the start, how can you expect the outcome be able to resolve your problems? Well, to be fair, it is a bottom-up public consultation, and many experts and academics were involved in drafting the public consultation document. Well, I think you cannot call it a fake consultation. Well, even if the financial secretary has approved the subsidy, when will it actually take effect? Our plan is to submit this paper to FC on the 10th of January. If everything is ready, we hope that starting from the month after approval by the FC, we will provide 4 months of subsidies. So you have to get the support of FC first. I don't think any of us will be against government subsidies. It's just because I have no other option. If I have the option, I'd rather they spend that $8.2 billion to buy their assets. I don't have a choice here. All right. The secretary has already replied to your suggestion. We'll urge them to consider further. All right. If members have no objection, the paper will go to FC. If there is no AOB, then the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.